Tomorrow, a hope for help tomorrow. No, no. I sleep with a sense of gratitude. And I sleep like a log. I sleep instantly. I sleep with energy. And of course, I also have help. I spend on help. I spend on help because I want energy. So I have somebody to help me out to sleep well. Means, in the sense, I'm by myself. So I'm my own master, you see? So it's a very important thing how you sleep. So I'm my own master, there are no demands on me. So I am my own master. So I sleep well, I sleep like a log, and I also help somebody. So you see, some of us use machines for let's say, acupressure or acupuncture, whatever. I also have help who presses my feet, who presses my feet or massages my feet. I help. I pay for it. I pay for it to get my energy. So while I sleep, somebody is pressing my feet and it's pumping a lot of oxygen into my whole body. You don't have that kind of facility and help, but you have to look for it, find it. Maybe it's a machine or maybe it's a human hand, we don't know. But something like this is very essential for us men and women. If there's house help, ask for it, seek it. And in many of the Southeast Asian countries and South Asian countries, some kind of help is still available for a few more years. After that, only the artificial intelligence and the machines alone will do it. So it's as long as it's good. So it's the way I sleep, number one. The way I get up, how I start my day. And I think Rajiv has already indicated to you something where he talked about the treadmill. It's a fact. I wake up early. I wake up about 5 in the morning. Between 5 and 5:30 I get up. I sleep, even if I sleep by 11, I get up fresh between 5 and 5:30 because I've been already refreshed by a good sleep and the energy which has got pumped in. Then I immediately read something fresh, something nice. I read, I look for nutrition. I scroll through my documents. I sometimes preserve the thought of the day or I pick up. So I tweet, Rajiv reads it. I tweet the morning nutrition. So that's a thought of mine. Like for instance, today, India is celebrating Constitution Day. So I've tweeted that duties come before rights. So if all of us observe our duties, everybody's rights is secure. But we look at my right. So I'm struggling for my right. Instead, I say, my responsibility. Then somebody else is protecting my rights because everybody's fulfilling a responsibility. And my rights are protected because I'm protecting others' rights by fulfilling a sense of responsibility. That's my tweet of the day, the morning nutrition, because we're celebrating Constitution Day today, the 70th Constitution of India today. It's when the Constitution was adopted and put in practice. So it's a way you start your day. I start with morning nutrition, not only for myself. Then I tweet it to 12 million people so that everybody comes in wildlife and alignment and they get the morning nutrition. But then I go to my treadmill and I have a wonderful desk on my treadmill. I scour through the newspapers. I listen to some music. I listen to the BBC news. I listen. So my ears are listening. My hands are scurrying through the newspapers. I'm still listening, but I'm also looking, glancing through the headlines of the newspapers, and I tick mark which paper, which portion of the newspaper I need to read a little more. So I tick mark so that I don't forget. So I hold it, and that means I'm actually giving a lot of positive energy information to myself. And if I like something of it, I even click it by my iPhone, save it to share it, or preserve it as my digital library. So that 1.5 hour in the morning, from almost 6 a.m. to almost 7:30 a.m. or 8 a.m., I'm reading, I'm watching, I'm in the part of nature, I'm drawing energy, I'm a part of yoga, I'm doing into meditation. So what I'm trying to say, all of us, the way we begin, suddenly putting on a coat and running for it, and then catching up a train, and then it's already, you are already rushed. You've not reflected, you've not given time to yourself. My source of energy comes from the way I sleep, go to sleep, with the thought I go to sleep, and the way I get up, and what kind of energy I give in the morning. This morning is been like this from my school time. From my school time, when I was competitive tennis, you've seen the film. I used to exercise and then go to school and then do my homework. But there was a lot of time lost. So even in my morning, I'm doing multi. I'm not losing a moment, but I'm drawing energy out of reading, exercising, yoga, nature, shooting pictures of birds, a little sparrow here and there. I record it. I just love it. After that, I'm done for the day. I have a plan for the day already. And that's it. So it's all choices made. The morning is also a choice. I can sleep. I can sleep extra. I can sleep heavy on my stomach and turn around to say, oh God, I ate too much. No, I don't. I let my stomach be light because I want to sleep light. So sleep light in your mind, sleep light on your stomach, and then get up light, and then spread joy and work. And so work becomes joy and it's planned. So I think if you ask me, what did I, part one of your question, I'm sorry I've explained it, because I know it happens. If you get an idea and if you get a practiced idea which works, practice, even if you have had stress at night and you had a challenge, doesn't matter. Get afresh, start afresh, read a little, get into a nature, and then get into back. You get your mind positivity and optimism back. What was your second part of the question? First part is where do you get your energy from? Second?
How you sustain the, I think it's somehow related, because you are always swimming against the current. It's very tiring, you know, the energy of the mental, the heart, the physical, it's all joined together. I'm so amazed with that. So I think you have answered a bit, maybe you want to elaborate more, Dr. Bedi?
You see, I've given you the foundation of my day. I don't sleep over my fears. Because I know every day is a new day. And every day will give me 24 hours to deal with it. My hours are not subtracted. Or I've eaten into. I eat into energy. I eat into energy if I sleep heavy. So every day has its new challenges. But since you freshened your mind, you cleared it of any clutter, there is no pressure on this of any cookies around. So you are dealing with every matter afresh. And when you are in the morning hour, it's the mind is actually giving a solution because you're not burdening with negativity. You're leaving it with positivity. And every day is a new challenge. The movie which you saw, I used to walk in the morning, answers came. So a lot of inner voice, remember, inner voice gives you the solution because you don't have any deceit in your mind. There's no deceit. I'm not scheming. I'm not into deceit. I'm not afraid. I know there's another day. And I'm not worried about tomorrow. What will happen? I must do the right thing today with fearlessly, with wisdom, of course, not foolishly, with wisdom, with consultation. You work with the team. You listen to the people. And you apply your own mind. You take guidance. It's not that you are only yourself. You work with the team. You consult, you realize, you consult your family, you have your friends, you have your confidants, and you talk. But it's not out of fear. It's out of solution providing. It's out of problem solving. It's not the problem. It's a solution of the problem. So it's not the problem. No. We have a problem, but what's the solution? Let's focus on that. So sometimes it's by yourself, and sometimes it's collectively. That's how I've lived one day at a time. And that's how it's been even now.
Thank you very much for that. And now I remember the last question that I asked you just now. Because every one of us makes mistakes in our life. So what is the biggest learning that you have throughout your life? That's what I want to ask. Thank you.
The learning here is nobody knows you better than your own self. I must know myself. I know myself. The more you know your own self, the more self-reliant will you be. And in the end, you are by yourself. And you have to be self-reliant. You may consult, you may hear, you may read, you may get. But in the end, all this learning is actually to know yourself. What is your purpose in life? What is my purpose? What am I here for? Who am I? What am I want to do? What is my life? What is that makes me happy? I must know myself. I must know my fears and I must know my strengths. I must do my own SWOT regularly. My strengths, my weaknesses, opportunities and threats. I must minimize my threats, my vision. So I alone have to be, first of all, my own friend, my own master. So my biggest lesson is continue to be aware of yourself and continue to know yourself and continue to seek help as you want.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. The way you feel. It's not the way you look. It's the way you feel. And that feeling is within you. So I think that's important. So it, but physical health gives you that internal health, because all the parameters. So therefore, I would say if the most successful we are is the healthier we are. That to me is a very big measure. But question is, what do we do with this good health? That's the point. What do we do? I've seen very healthy people in my prison. They're very healthy. They were big, right? They were strong. What did they do with that health? They abused it. It's the use of your energy. It's the way what makes you. And that choice you make every day. So health is also, good health is also a choice. And the use of the health is a choice. Making good health is a choice. Generating energy is a choice. And the use of that health is also a choice. So you see how we make our choices. So this is what I think it would be successful so far, is that I've been able to generate, I'm a generator within. It's like creating my own luck, I would say. I write my own luck. It's creating your own luck every day by generating the right amount of solar energy. Solar energy or environmental energy.
Hi, Dr. Bedi. It's very inspiring to see you in the last night. I can't believe that I've seen you through Skype today. So one question that I would like to ask you is that in life there are a lot of ups and downs. So in the moment that when you're down, how did you motivate yourself to come out again and rise again and even raise up stronger?
Well, you get mentally strong only by upgrading your skills on a regular basis. It's an upgradation of skills. Knowing more, learning. You know, in our lives, there's no finishing line. There's no finishing line. Okay, here's my line, finished. Every day is a new day to learn more. So you stretch. There's no finishing line. You've got to keep the jog. You keep, even if you don't want to, keep the marathon. Life is a marathon. After all, I've done my 70 years now. It's been a marathon of 70 years. I don't know how long this marathon. Can I say, no, I stop here? I can change my way of living. Means I can change my route. Today I'm an administrator here. I can tomorrow become a traveler. Or I can go to the pilgrimages as I want. Not somebody imposes it on me. As my choice. So I think this is very critical, is to understand that in life there is no finishing line. There's no finishing line. That basically means keep learning. So how do you make yourself strong as a woman or otherwise is keep reinventing yourself. Keep re-energizing yourself. Keep rewriting for yourself. So reinvent, keep a cleaning with your own. So it's like, it's like reinvention. Continue to reinvent. Reinvention happens, and I have to learn. That's why I start, I say, when you learn in the morning, when you read in the morning, what are you doing? You're upskilling yourself. So the whatever, that's why you're coming for training programs. Why do we go for training? It's to reinvent, to re-energize, to relearn, and you stretch your finishing line. You are not into a finishing line. You push it back, and you continue to learn. I do that every morning. I do that every night. I do that as much as I when I travel, and I inspire myself all sources of inspiration. I use a lot of watch a lot of biographies of success stories and history on the Netflix. Because I don't go to the cinema theater because I don't have the patience for sit 3 hours because I can't fast forward a movie. But I watch it on Netflix. So on the Netflix, when I watch a good documentary, then I can. While I'm taking my food, I watch the little Netflix on my table with my iPad. So while I'm eating, the television is on hold. You know that soft, it's mute, sorry. Television was mute and it's telling me the headline. That's good enough. I don't want the noise of the television. I only want to read the headline. So that's mute, and I have my iPad on my dining table, this thing. So I watch a documentary and I pause it when I want. I pause it. And then I go back to it the next next day. I can see it in installments, but it inspires me. When I read geniuses, like the other day, I saw the film on Bill Gates, the mind, what has made him so brilliant? I watch a lot of historical and documentaries on Netflix in parts. So once it inspires me, I pause it. Ah, that's good enough for me for a nutrition. I get recharged and that's it. So Netflix is a big source of visual, because when you see visually, it settles with you. So it inspires people on the Netflix, the biographies, the documentaries. I don't see anything which drains me. I see everything which re-energizes me. That's what I do every day. You see, it's not being a man or a woman. It's a person in you. So it's a person, the same thing is with the man, if he could do the same thing. But the woman has many more responsibilities, or she takes on more responsibilities. So how do you manage those extra responsibilities or certain expectations from your child? You can't tell your child, now you sit down, now you go to sleep, I'm going to do this. You have to co-opt him. How do you get his cooperation with you? Like, I had a lot of family support, as you saw in the movie. So that's what I do. I use my time in no way to dissipate energy, and that's how I get my. So take in life, there is no finishing line. Every day, it's a new day, and rework it.
Hey, who wants to go next?
Hi, Dr. Bedi. Okay, one question for me, which is, I wonder, is it your ambition to be, I see you as a very successful leader, is it your ambition to be a successful leader?
Ambition to be what?
A leader.
A leader?
Successful leader.
I was a born leader.
Is it your ambition? Is it
no,
born
it's not an ambition,
leader?
It's a habit. It's a habit to decide for yourself, to be in command and control. And then you lead yourself. You begin with leading yourself and you become a leader for others. It's like you first take charge of yourself and you lead yourself with it. I think I was a leader from the age of 9, 10 when I started to play and I started to take my decisions. What is leadership? It's all the time taking decisions. So first you start taking decisions for yourself. And then you impact what is around you and your responsibility for you. Then you start taking decisions with each other or for each other, right? So I think I was a born leader in the sense that from the age of 9, maybe I was inspired by my parents to say, hey, decide, you go, you challenge, take a risk, get out of comfort zone, do more. See, when they trained me to do more, that is leadership. Doing is leadership. So I think I was groomed to be taking these decisions and risks, and I start to grow into that habit. So I start after a while. First, it's like you being sent into a swimming pool, okay? And you're sitting on the side and say, that's lovely, swimming pool. Swimming is great fun. And somebody says, hey, you want to learn swimming? Get into the pool. But I'm afraid that the coach helps you. Say, okay, I'll hold you. Here's an air tube. You swim along, paddle along, and do these exercises. And then you suddenly get the tube off. Who pushed you into the swimming? Did you push yourself? Or a coach pushed you? It's your choice. I think for me, my parents pushed me into this environment. They gave me a great environment. And after that, I start to swim by myself. And then I start to hold their hand to say, come with me for swimming. See? So it's the way. It's the constant learning by your own self. So it's, you have to. When I was 16, 17, and then I was traveling all my, which means I was planning for myself, strategizing for myself, competing for myself. It's all about leadership. What else is leadership? Then I became help to others. So it's a growth. Leadership is a growth. And remember, as I said, there's no finishing line. It's a constant growth. So leadership, you may be born with it, you may be given it. It's a subtle analysis, research. But you are both born and made. But made by yourself. You are given an environment, or you give yourself an environment. After that, every day, you make yourself. You are showing leadership by coming to these programs. You had a choice to say no. You had a choice to say, no, I have something more important, I have to. That's leadership. You are making choices to constantly learn for yourself, to grow in your own thinking, in decision-making power, in analysis, in strategizing, in knowing yourself more and understanding your purpose. I think that's what leadership is about. So it's a constant growth. You grow, you are given, you grow, and then you continue to add to it.
Thank you, Dr. Bedi. Hi, Dr. Bedi. You're very inspirational and also very wise hearing from you. Having gone through 7 decades of a very fulfilling life, I was just wondering, do you have advice to your younger self? Let's say if you were to give an advice to yourself 30 years ago, what advice would you give to yourself?
Repeat that again, little.
What advice would you give to yourself that is 30 years ago?
30 years
what,
ago?
What advice would you give?
If I go back 30 years ago? If I go back 30 years,
yes.
What would be my
yes.
advice to myself?
Yes.
Oh. I would have read more. I would have read more. I would have made more friends. And I would have kept the contact with me. And not lost the contact. I wish I had the kind of technology we have today. We didn't have the technologies when I was in school. So I don't have the address book. I want to trace my friends, I don't get them. I would have read more. I would have made more friends and kept the contact with me. Third, certainly I would have spent more time with my family. I would have talked more. I would have conversed more with my parents. I would have played more with my child. So I think there's always a scope to do more. But if you know, when I look back, did I have that bandwidth? I ask myself, did I have that bandwidth? And I ask myself, yes, probably there was. So I would say, factor all these things in your life, proportionately, beautifully, and achieve all you can. To my mind, I think I could have done all this little more. More here and more there. I could have worked more. All I can say is I don't think I could have worked more. Because I worked to the maximum, the work required. Where I did not compromise at all was work. Because work was demanding. I could say, you wait. Like the doctor can't say, hey patient, you wait. You can't. So I was in an emergency work. So I had to respond with a sense of urgency and emergency. Rest was all balanced. But in that balance, I don't know, maybe I certainly could have done a bit more. More friends, maybe shared more dinner with my friends. I may not have gone out for many times because time was a big... I had a time famine then. I had time famine even now. So there's something called time famine. So time famine was even then. So, but I think there's a scope for 30 years back. I wish we had the technology we have today. I didn't have this technology on WhatsApp, my address book on electronic, my electronic library, my computer systems, these technologies, but there was greater human contact at that time. So I think that human contact would have been built a little more. I think that area, I could have done a bit more and kept the contact with me. So I can stay, but I still have many. If I can go back to my school friend, I still have her. So I retrieved a bit, but I still cannot retrieve all others I still remember. Yeah.
Hi, Dr. Bedi. I just want to ask you one question. You said you have made a choice in your life. So do you ever feel regret of any choices that you ever made in your life? Thank you.
As I said, me to a buffet dinner, if you take me to the buffet dinner, so do I regret what I did not eat, or do I say I loved what I ate? So when you have a buffet dinner, there's a Chinese meal, there's an Indian meal, alright? There's a cold food, salads, etc. I can eat all. Can I eat all? No, I can't. I can't eat all. I make my choices because that's what suits my feet. Because I, first of all, cannot eat all. Yeah, I can pick, I can make my plate the way I want. My plate is my choice. And as long as that plate is my choice food, I thoroughly love it. I nourish myself and I get energy out of it. But if I get confused and say, oh, there's so much, I should have everything, and I take everything, I make a mess of the food, and I want to leave the plate as it is, abandoned, say, hey, the food wasn't good. But it was my fault. Why did I mess it up? Why did I mess my food? So, In the buffet of life, your wisdom is pick and choose what you need, what is at what's your passion or what's your preference, and what suits your body, what suits you biologically, what attracts you, what is natural to you, what's tasty for you, and that you would love to have it again and again. Like I have milk again and again every day. I'm a milker. So, I have made my milk again and again. So even if there's a buffet, I still go back to the milk. Because that's my first choice. So am I sacrificing other stuff? No, I'm not sacrificing. And number two, it doesn't tempt me either. It doesn't tempt me. So there's no regret. Because it never tempted me. So things in our lives, which many others do, they don't attract me. They don't tempt me. So I don't regret it, because they never tempted me. It was not my need. My needs are very clear. So the greater clarity you have in your life, or what are your needs and preferences, you enjoy them. And then say, oh, I didn't have that. Like for instance, I don't have lovely long hair. It's a choice to keep it short, because this is the way I want to. It meets my needs, and I like myself. I like myself the way I look. I don't care whether you like it or not. So in regrets are, I think, is when you want something and you can't take it. No, I don't want it. I don't want it. I didn't need it. It's not important to me. And I make my choices. And there's no time to regret. Why should I regret when it's my choice? Oh, I didn't have more than one child. I chose to have only one child. Why? Because I can't continue to have children. So, it's my choice. My husband wanted another. I said, no. I said, you want another? Then you shift from Amritsar to Delhi and you nurture the child. You nurture the child. Number two, I can't get out of my uniform every time. And I have to first get out of it and then get into it. So these are choices we make. So I don't regret having not many children. I don't. That's my choice I made. Simple. But I like when people have time for large families. Very nice. That's their choice. I'm so happy that they're happy in that. Okay? I hope I've explained it.
Hello, hi Dr. Bedi. I have one question for you. So many people, I'm sure, find you as an inspiration and as a role model. So I'm just wondering, who's your role model and why? Thank you.
My role model is every day. Ideas coming from all directions. It may come from Gandhi, it may come from Bill Gates, it may come from successful entrepreneurs, it may come from teachers, books, it may come from books, including the one Raji wrote. It comes from all directions. I don't stop at a person. Look, no one person has all the ideas. There's something unique in everybody's life. Pick up that. To me, that's an inspiration. If Gandhi's simplicity, it attracts me. His authenticity, it attracts me. Bill Gates, the way he's at it and constantly, and he's gifted. He's a gifted man. I'm only sorry just because I recently watched his, so it's supermost in my mind. But I see all the legends. Everybody, if you look back to the legends, the Nobel laureates, everybody had a separate gift. So if you start looking at, that's your role model. So I get inspiration from people, ideas, books, films, occasions, situations. Even a child is a so what is a role model? Which you like to be, which you want to imbibe. But you need not be another person. You can still be yourself. So that means within myself, within my own personhood, I imbibe these positive sun rays into mine and make my energy. So I'm not a person who says, that's my model, I'll only follow them. I don't follow anybody. I follow good ideas, I imbibe, not even follow, I imbibe ideas and apply them in my work life and in my personal life. So imbibing new ideas is actually from various people who inspire you. And as I said, this person, nobody better than Gandhi, who's all over the world forever. What he stood for, consistency, sacrifice. In fact, he sacrificed, but he made a choice, as I said. People say he sacrificed. He did. He made every fast of his was a choice for a curve, for a higher purpose. Every fast of his was for a higher purpose, for the independence of his country. It wasn't a sacrifice. He never sacrificed his life. We think he sacrificed. No, it was a choice. And he loved, he actually nurtured every moment of his by his own thinking. So friends, that's how, for me, role model is. Every day I search for ideas. I look for new nutrition and I share it. And then that becomes me, and then I look for more. I'm hungry. So why should you stick to one role model? Remain hungry for open up a variety and a bouquet of ideas and keep imbibing and nutritioning them. So be your own role model. So in the end, I told you, nobody knows you more yourself. Keep upskilling yourself and be proud of who you are. Most important thing is, how proud are you of your own self? You must be predictable to yourself that if such a situation comes, this is going to be my prediction. Come what may, this is who I am. Predictable to your juniors, predictable to your team. That if you, in fact, here, we are, the Lieutenant Governor office is so predictable to the rest of Pondicherry here. You have a population of about 14 lakh, and each one of them say, if injustice happens, and a file of injustice comes to the Lieutenant Governor's office, justice will happen. Am I able to live up to this? Yes. Is my office going to be living up to this? Yes. Come what may, injustice will not be allowed to happen, whoever you may be. So I think role modeling is the kind of predictability. Gandhiji was predictable. That if this happens, this is the way he will behave. So friends, I think this, to my mind, is real message of role modeling. Is to be with, to know your own self and be confident and be happy and proud. And then more go into your internal audits. Internal audit is very, very important, listening to your inner voice. Constantly being with yourself. It's not necessary you sit. You can even, while being with yourself, a thought will come and ask yourself, what can I do better? Where can I learn better? Who can I learn from better? Who would I like to be at the moment to take inspiration? Just make these choices on a regular basis.
Dr. Bedi, you've touched upon the question I'm about to ask. That is, we have about 5 minutes left. What has been the traditional role of the lieutenant governor or a governor of a state in India, and how have you redefined it since you took office?
From a ceremonial figurehead ceremonial figurehead, a titular head, and a distant invisible position, we made into a people nivas from a royal kind of a palace with shut doors. We opened the doors, and there are certain time of the doors open to visitors here, and we've had thousands of people visiting us from all parts of the world. They come in, they see around this place, leave little remark, get photographed here, see a bit of information. The French says, oh, thank you for maintaining our building so well. And others say, what a royal building. But it's open. It's open to people, visitors. Then there is a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, people are. Anybody takes a token, and for 3 hours to 2.5 hours, we sit and listen to them. I've addressed large number of petitions. By opening the door with the predictability of Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, fixed 2.5 hours, dedicated to the people, do you know what's happened? All my other departments are open too, because the people say, you don't listen to us now, we go to the Lieutenant Governor's office. So with the result, everybody had to open the door, because the last door isn't available even as a first door. So I want this to be a last door. But it's even as a first door. You don't listen, I'm going there. Many children come for cricket bats here. Their mother didn't give them a cricket bat. And they say, okay, we go to Madam Lieutenant Governor, she will give us a cricket bat. There's even the children feel so. So what I'm saying, we have created a system of environment of work where people are welcome, of course, without compromising security. Security protocol remains intact. But there's a system. Why should I shut the door when security can take care of them? And why should people wait to come to us? Why can't we connect with people? So the opening of the system to regular visitors and grievance addressal and regular meetings here and constant interaction and constant media communication, we have made our Lieutenant Governor's office a communicative with the connecting with the people. And we've shed the very stiff protocols. We've shed it. We constantly have events here, festivals here, exhibitions here, children, women, aging, senior citizens, all sections are coming repeatedly. So it's a grievance redressal system, and it's an openness, open house that has changed the way Lieutenant Governor's office earlier, and then going on the weekends. Weekends we are cycling out, we bike out, I love my fitness, so you see I bike out on the streets with the team here, so we go to a problem area which we want to see or a visit home or a family, it depends, we plan the weekend of Saturday, Sunday, we use it as an outdoor, so weekends are used very well. I use my weekend morning, Saturday, Sunday for connecting with the people at the doorstep, in the village, in the area, to a pond, to a lake, and they see us there and the children connect. So it's connecting to at the grassroots level, and then they also have an option to come to us. So it's like a two-way traffic. You come to us, we come to you. And during the Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday open house, they come and invite you, saying, Madam, could you come over the weekend? We have an issue, we have a problem. And we accept it and we go there. Sometimes we bike, sometimes we go by car, sometimes we walk. And sometimes we play, we take volleyballs and say we play in the village with the children and the women. So you see, it's an integrated community. That's what this office was meant for. And not to be distant, ceremonial, and sitting with false egos. There's no ego here. It's all about giving. Lieutenant Governor office now is all about giving from the privilege and the power and responsibility it is endowed with by law and by rules.
I know your time is very precious, and you've given us 45 minutes. We are very grateful. One thing I have to tell you is that she is one of our most special friends of Icliff. Every time there is a request for her time from Icliff, she has never said no. So for that, we are very grateful. Thank you very much once again, and God bless you. Trying to learn from you.
The strength behind Rajiv is his wife called Vandana.
Thank you.
Vandana is a real strength behind Rajiv. She is a permanent partner, a remarkable partner. Energy, thinking, support, and good health. It's Vandana is a secret. You must ask him, how does he keep Vandana so much on his right? Ask him.
I think now you are spilling family secrets. So I have to say.
All right. Bye-bye. Thank you.